Episode 5 of HBO's The Undoing was titled Trial by Fury. On the first day of trial, prosecutor Catherine Stamper presents the overwhelming physical evidence while Haley questions whether Detective Mendoza pursued all possible leads. Later, Henry is forced to divulge a secret he's been keeping from his mother. Hey, what's going on, everybody, and welcome back to my channel, Movie Files. I am back again with my weekly recap, breakdown, and review of the latest episode of HBO's The Undoing. We're talking episode 5, which unfortunately means we only got one episode left, but this episode, Trial by Fury, so much to break down. We'll talk about stuff that I talked about a couple weeks ago. We find out some stuff about Jonathan and our boy Henry. Very excited to break it all down in the spoiler discussion before we dive into the details. As you can see on the screen now, make sure you're following me on all my other social media accounts. That way you all can stay up to date on what's going on over here at Movie Files. If you are new to the channel, welcome to the community. Consider subscribing, and while you're at it, hit that notification bell so you don't miss any of my other Undoing reviews, other TV coverage, movie reviews, live streams, all the fun things we do on this very channel. It would mean a lot to me if you all can share this video and give it a thumbs up. It helps out the channel, but I also really appreciate it. And in the comments below, let's discuss this episode from the beginning all the way to the end. Again, we're full of spoilers here, so what do we think about Henry? We talked about it a couple weeks ago. I got a couple clips I'm gonna show you guys here in a bit, but is it too easy to be Henry? Is he covering for his dad? Is it a huge misdirect? We're going to break it all down, but I want to know what you all think about this episode and what you expect to see in next week's finale. I don't watch the previews and the trailers for next week, so I go into it completely blind, but I want to know what you all think about what we can expect in next week's series finale. So before I even get into my overall thoughts, get into the recap and the breakdown, take a quick look at a couple things that we talked about a couple weeks ago. But we know what's going on. Jonathan's obviously on the run. But I wonder if it is pointing towards that Henry might know some things about his dad. I mean, just last week, he found out that his dad, I don't want to say he's a liar to his son, but again, he kind of lied about the story about the dog, why they can't have a dog. But we know that his dog was killed, and he, you know, gave his son the soft blow of why he doesn't want the dog. But again, it's just like little Easter eggs of just like this family. You know, Henry, Jonathan, you know, and especially Grace, they have this idea of what their family is, but what really is it, right? What is the secrets this family holds? And I think, I don't know if I'm looking too much into Henry covering for his dad, or if he's just being optimistic. First half of this episode really kind of points a light at Henry and his kind of his mindset. So after seeing his father being taken away by the police, the first thing he decides to do is go upstairs and play his violin. Now, if you guys remember from episode 1, him and his father had a little conversation, truly probably their last conversation before all this went down. Jonathan pokes fun at his son keeping up with his violin lesson. So by Henry going upstairs playing his violin, is that just kind of like him paying some type of respect to his dad? Like, you know what? My dad's going through all this, but I'm going to at least keep up with my studies, keep up with my practice with my violin. Or is there something a little bit more loose up there in his screws of escaping the situation, or maybe hiding something? And we'll talk more about hiding and Henry a little bit later. See, there's a lot of details in the opening sequence. I don't want to spend too much time on it because there's a lot to break down in this episode, but there is something that someone mentioned last week, and there is something that I kind of caught as well. I marked it down in my notes here at a minute 26 seconds. If you look at the intro, and I'm going to put it on the screen now, that's a boy. That is a little boy. Now, who is that little boy? Is that Grace's brother that we don't know about? Did he pass away? Is this another family entirely? We assume that that little girl is Grace, but could it be maybe that Henry and Grace had another child before, you know, Henry was around? Did the little girl pass away? Did Grace have something to do with it? So that's something to look into, is who is that little boy? He's seen kind of throughout the intro there, but in particularly on the 1 minute and 26 second mark, you can see that clearly is a little boy. So let me know your thoughts on that. I just wanted to kind of...
So as you all can see from those clips, we talked about this a couple weeks ago. Should we be keeping an eye on Henry? Is it strange, the things that he was doing? Is he covering up for his dad? Does he have his secrets of his own? And we get a lot of that in this episode. I'm going to, of course, break it down. But man, I don't know. I'm still kind of, again, what we learn about Jonathan, I think, is more revealing than what we learned about Henry, with everything with his sister, which we talked about that in the intro and all that stuff that goes on in the beginning of the show. So there's a lot to really go into, but getting into this kind of breakdown, but overall thoughts of this episode, the trial by Fury, which is a word on play in the courtroom type of situations, whereas essentially they call it a trial by jury, where you want the jury to believe this particular image that you want to portray to the media. And we see that with Haley's advice to playing to the media, right? Showing this happy family, this unit that's tied together. So very interesting title.
a lot of stuff to break down, but just initial thoughts of this episode. I thought it was fantastic through and through. Of course, the performances, we always talk about it every week. I think Noah Jope really kind of showed his acting chops in this episode. Again, Jonathan, man, Hugh Grant, just being that, he can talk his way out of anything as we see him getting Grace to the house and the stuff at the end, man. He's a psychopath, man, sociopath, as they say later in the episode with Sylvia and the reveal from his mother. So overall, I thought this was a fantastic episode. I think this show has given us a huge misdirect with Henry, maybe, you know, with the whole thing with the hammer in his violin case. But we'll talk about that once we get to the breakdown. But I just wanted to let you all know I really enjoyed this episode. I think it really shapes up a finale that I think we're all going to be satisfied with, hopefully. So let's get into the recap. The episode opens up with Henry watching television, watching his dad, and particularly after we see him talking about, you know, he thinks he has an idea who he thinks the killer is, and we'll talk about who Jonathan may think the killer is a little bit later. But really interesting to see. Again, we always see Henry watching the news. Could it be because he wants to know what evidence is out there? If his dad is guilty, is the police looking at another suspect like himself? Very interesting to say the least. As we move forward, we see for the very first time in this entire show, at least since the death of Elena, we see Jonathan ask Grace, why were you walking in the area near her apartment when she died? Were you following me? And this is something to keep an eye out for Jonathan. Him, these jokes, right? He's a very joking guy. We've seen that kind of side of him throughout the season. But in this episode particularly, he seems to kind of make, I don't want to say jokes of the situation, because this is a very, you know, murder case, right? But he tends to throw in these jokes. And that goes back to, which we'll talk a little bit about later, his empathy, lack of empathy, I should say, right? His emotionless type of reaction to what's going on. And we'll talk about what his mother revealed to us a little bit later. But again, little tidbits of Jonathan always poking, making light of the situation. But nonetheless, we see Grace pushes him. As like, why would you say something like that? We see that there's people, there's fans of Jonathan, there's paparazzi of Jonathan. But again, something to keep note of, these jokes, these emotionless type of moments that we get with Jonathan in this very serious case. Okay, so moving forward, we see Haley reinsures Jonathan and reinsures to Grace that everything right now, the case is just circumstantial, right? There's no murder weapon. Their strategy right now which is a very interesting, strategic way to go into this trial, which is just wait and see. If knock on wood, I'm never in a position that, you know, these characters are ever in. But if my lawyer says something like that, I would just be sweating bullets. But nonetheless, we'll talk about Haley, which, man, my Perry Mason fans out there that watched Perry Mason on HBO earlier this year, and of course the Perry Mason show back in the day and stuff like that. But Haley is a hell of a lawyer, and we'll talk about her in a bit. But either way, she kind of gives us the breakdown of what we can expect. Again, trial by fury, aka trial by jury. She gives us the breakdown of everyone that's involved. There's seven women in the jury. There are two of them that's been cheated on, like Grace. And also there's a guy who's having an affair with his wife. And Haley knows every single thing about the jury via social media. So again, it plays into that title. Again, you want to know every single body, everyone in that jury, so you can make that personal connection. You can tie the pieces together. You can show yourself as like a victim, right? They're showing themselves as this family. So again, Haley is really working this trial, guys. She's lived up to the hype as a great lawyer, as they continuously say it throughout this the show so far. So moving forward, we see Haley suggests that they go after Fernando, which we'll talk about a little bit later, because she says that his alibi is very weak. She urges Grace to take the hand of Jonathan. Again, them planting the seeds of them being a happy family, a wife that's standing by her husband on trial. So again, it's all the little details that we see of selling the jury of this image that she wants to create for the media to see. So again, Haley's working she's working the case. I'm telling you all, she's great at her job. She's really awesome. She's a great character too. So we move forward. We see that there's more news discussing the position of the rich. We saw that a couple episodes ago in regards to how if someone else was in this position, someone other than the position that they're in, a doctor with money, you know, a father with money, Grace the therapist, if they weren't in their positions that they're in, if the shoe was on the other foot, hypothetically, if, you know, Fernando was sleeping with Grace and Grace ended up murder and Fernando is this, you know, father and Elena is this mother that works at a studio, they wouldn't be getting these same, you know, type of circumstances, right? They would probably be locked up. The trial would be done within a day, right? So I love how the show's just showing us another layer of, like, sometimes it pays to have a little bit of money in your pocket. So that's definitely something to kind of look into that the show's definitely pointing a light at. But as we kind of move forward, we see that Grace tells her dad that you got to play a role in this, dad. You got to kind of live up to this whole family being a strong unit, again, just to kind of sell that to the jury and sell that to the public, as we kind of see there. And then, you know, something that we also kind of notice within the scene, we see Franklin tells Grace that this isn't helping Henry, no matter if his father is a murderer or not. We need to keep him away from his father as far as possible. And I'm thinking to myself, well, it might be a little bit too late for that, Franklin, because it seems like Henry may have picked up a couple traits from his dad. I don't know, maybe lying to his mother, and then also, I don't know, maybe they're murderers. So you got a father and a dad. The apple doesn't fall too far from the tree, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But moving forward, we get the first day of the trial. We see Jonathan and Grace making their way into the courtroom, holding hands. Again, Haley making that perfect picture, making the jury seem like they're a good family. And then we see, you know, Franklin and Henry making their way into the trial. And again, this is day one. So as we kind of break down this scene, we see Catherine gives her opening statements. We see that she starts with the affair. She goes into the night of Elena's death, that, you know, they had sex that night, Jonathan and Elena. And, you know, she goes into the details about the affair, and she brings in that hammer. And I thought it was very interesting that the camera pans over to, you know who, Henry. And then as she kind of goes into her statements, we see that she continuously emphasizes the fact that Jonathan continuously hit her in the head with that hammer. Her face was liquidy, going into all the brutal details, and she continuously is just hitting the hammer on her hand over and over and over again. We see Jonathan, or I should say, we see Grace and Henry getting upset about this, right? And we'll talk about the differences of the emotion throughout this trial. But she brings up in her closing statement to the jury, it's worse than you think. So she kind of, again, alludes to Jonathan having this affair, having this, you know, this lies, and he was a bad man, and he brutally killed this woman out of passion, out of fear of maybe having his family's life kind of crumbling apart if she were to spill the beans potentially of this affair. So, you know, 1 point for Catherine. As we move forward, it is now Haley's turn, and she turns on the TV. We get Elena on the television as Grace recalls the night of the benefit. She has a little bit of a flashback of herself. You know, Haley does such a great job in this trial, guys. Like I said, for my Perry Mason fans out there, she really did a good job in this trial. Haley goes into the fact that Jonathan made love to Elena that night of her death, and Jonathan just happened to be the one to blame. Again, she's just using this against her advantage in regards to the police just has to find someone to blame, right? You were there, your semen was there, this, that, and the other. Again, she's just planting the seeds of, again, changing the narrative and really getting into the public's eye and getting into their goodwill. And then she brings in the fact that, what about Fernando? You know, his alibi isn't really that strong. He has a motive, an angry husband that finds out that his wife having an affair. Very interesting way to kind of twist that, right? And it ends with Jonathan kind of in a good stance after the first day of the trial. Again, Catherine did her thing, you know, pointing out the things about the affair, but again, Haley, she's really kind of winning the, at least from my perspective, she was kind of winning her side of the case. So as we kind of move forward, we see Jonathan watching the news as the news breaks that they're now kind of pointing the light at Fernando. We hear one of the news reporters say, well, this is just kind of a move of desperation of a sense, because there's no evidence proving that Fernando is guilty. So as we kind of move forward, we see Jonathan goes into the room, takes a picture off the wall, and I am to assume that's a picture of Henry. Again, if you saw my review last week, I alluded to maybe they had a son, and the son passed away, but I'm pretty sure that picture that he pulled down was actually Henry. It could be someone else, but I'm pretty sure that was Henry. But moving forward, we go see Franklin playing the piano as Grace tries to fall asleep. She gets a call from Jonathan. And again, this goes back to me talking about Jonathan and his ways of kind of manipulating the situation and being this charming guy. We see that Jonathan tries to invite Grace to the house. You know, at first she denies. As the conversation goes on, he continues to joke, lighten the situation right over the phone. Again, he finds these ways to be kind of jokey and then again emotionalist, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But you know, he talks about, oh, how was your day? You know, obviously her day was terrible. She had to go on be in the courtroom of you being accused for murder. But you know, they have this conversation about their early days in the marriage, and they kind of rekindle this, and she eventually smiles. They hang up the phone, and he tells her, you know, that he loves her. And again, this kind of goes to show his charming nature, because we see that eventually Grace gets up, takes her little nightly stroll, and she makes her way to her home. As the scene kind of moves forward, we see that she walks into the bedroom. She lays next to Jonathan. They embrace each other. They start to kiss. And we can imagine what happened that night because it just cuts to the next morning. And again, it just goes to show you, man, he's like a fungus, Jonathan. He could just make his way into your skin, get under your skin. He finds a way of manipulating the situation. This goes back to what Stuart was saying a couple weeks ago about him having this God complex. This goes back to, you know, Sylvia kind of giving her two cents on him. Obviously, Franklin isn't a big fan of him. There is something to be said about Jonathan's behavior in this situation, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But moving forward, we see Grace making a quote-unquote walk of shame back to her father's place, and we see her son, again, father like son, kind of, you know, being a little creepy there as he's there, you know, and says, "Oh, mom, where have you been?" You know, and she tells him, you know, she had to take a walk, this, that, and the other. And she mentions to him, which is very interesting, going back to this Grace blinking out, blacking out, and we'll talk about it a little bit later. But she says to him, "We'll survive this. You know, if we survive this trial, we can survive anything." She asks, "What's wrong with Henry? Henry seems to be hiding something." And this is a big moment here. He saw his dad and Elena at school. As we kind of break down the scene, we get this flashback with Henry seeing them across the street. It appears that Jonathan was uncomfortable in this situation. Again, this is from the POV of Henry. So very similar to like his mother and very similar to anyone. You kind of paint your own picture of the situation. So in that kind of flashback of Henry telling his mom what he saw, who knows, maybe Jonathan was happy and smiling and could have been really excited to see his side piece, right? Or it could have been the case that he was uncomfortable and Lena had, you know, these type of obsession problems with her. But again, based on his father telling him that she was obsessed, based on the information that he's gotten from the news, based on the fact that he just loves his dad and just sees perfection, very similar to how Grace sees her father or saw her father at a young age, that he was just perfect and he was a perfect husband, a perfect dad. It's kind of the same thing with Henry. He just sees his dad as this saint. He's a perfect person, and it's something to very keep an eye on with as far as this obsession with his father being perfect. So, but we see, you know, that scene kind of play out. He kind of mentions that Henry believes it's his fault by not saying anything. He tells his mom, Grace, that they weren't kissing or anything, but Jonathan actually saw his dad smile at him and wave. Again, is it Henry making that up? Making that up like, oh, the dad was just kind of there, like, hey, like nothing was happening. Did the psychopath Jonathan literally just wave at his son after his son just saw him kind of like literally flirting with this woman? Who can we trust in the situation? But very interesting to see the least. He knew that I knew is what Henry says in regards to him seeing that. So obviously Henry wanted to tell his mom, but, you know, wanted his dad. He felt like his dad trusted him. So this is where I want to go back to. This goes back to my theories weeks ago about Henry getting upset about this, right? About this whole idea that Henry doesn't want his family to be broken up and that he has this connection to his dad and this secret that he wants to keep for his dad. Is that in the same vein that his dad may have saw his son murder this woman, brutally murder her, and he's keeping a secret from himself? So again, which way are you guys leaning towards? Are we thinking that Jonathan, after the reveal that we'll talk about with Katie, his sister, or are we thinking that Henry literally does not want to see his family broken up and he sees a threat in his family and he takes it upon himself to eliminate that threat? Let me know where you guys are at. As we kind of move forward, we see Grace confronts Jonathan next morning about what she just learned. Haley steps in to reminds them that they have a task at hand and that, you know, they have to get into the game. They have to kind of put this aside, this big reveal, and kind of go into day two, I believe, of the trial. We see on this next day of the trial, Detective Mendoza takes the stand as Catherine shows the courtroom. Elena's battered and bashed in face. Again, the brutality of that murder was insane. Small detail, but we can see the people in the courtroom getting very uncomfortable about the image of Elena's face being bashed in. And it's very interesting. We see Grace is almost emotionless in this scene, right? She seems, again, who knows, she's seen this image a couple times now. She's just kind of still in shock shell after finding out that her son just saw her dad, you know, around another woman. But I thought it was very interesting, again, this family with emotions and lack of emotions and jokingly and how Jonathan handles certain things, how Henry handles things, how Grace handles things. This family has a very interesting way to display emotion. So as we kind of move forward, Haley brings back and highlights the lack of concrete evidence that Jonathan was, you know, yeah, his spit was there, his bodily fluids were there. I mean, hell, there was a shoe print of the blood of him, but that isn't enough, right? We see Haley goes into it for the very first time that I can recall. She brings up the fact that Fernando was actually on at the case, right? And apparently after he heard the news, you know, he went down there and, you know, Haley brings up the fact that his DNA could have been there the night before. And Detective Mendoza stands on his ground of Fernando being clear. So Haley is really working this trial as she's kind of highlighting these big things. We see Haley brings up the fact that Grace was there. And man, is this a bold move that she kind of plays here? I thought this was a very bold move. So as we kind of see in the scene, she brings up the fact that, you know, there was video footage of Grace near the crime scene, but no DNA. And we see Detective Mendoza talking about where there wasn't any video of Fernando. That's kind of his alibi. There's no evidence of this man being there. There's no video evidence. But yet we pull Grace in to question her because we have video evidence, no DNA, but no video for Fernando, but DNA. So again, it was just very, very witty of her to kind of use that to her advantage. I thought that, again, going back to my Perry Mason fans out there, that was just a hell of a lawyer move for her to kind of call, again, using the wife of the man accused for murder as a framing device to kind of put the fact that the detective lied about not having any other evidence and then using it against him. Brilliant stuff. I'm not a lawyer, but man, that was some Law and Order, Perry Mason stuff to another level there. Let me know what you all thought about Haley lawyering skills in that moment. We see Jonathan and Grace and Henry having lunch as we kind of move forward from that scene. And we see Henry seems to be very confident about the trial. He feels like his father's in a good position. Jonathan seems kind of uncomfortable about the fact that, you know, Fernando's in the mix. And interesting that Grace didn't remember this line. So we see Grace or, you know, Henry bring up the fact that, remember, Mom, you said if we can survive this trial, we can survive as a family. And she's like, I said that? He's like, yeah, you said it last night. She's like, oh, okay. This goes back to our conversations about Grace. She forgets things. She blacks out. She suppresses her emotions. She suppresses her trauma. Very interesting moment there when she says that. But kind of moving forward, Henry suggests that the family will get back together and they're going to win this trial, and calls out the hypocrisy of Grace's job. Like, well, if you don't think we could be back to the family, you say this about, you know, your clients and your patients, about a husband or a wife, to, you know, cheating on each other, having an affair. They can come back together. They can be stronger than ever. Can't we do that? Very interesting way. Again, Henry and Jonathan, man, those guys have a way with words, right? They really make you feel a certain way in regards to how they frame things. But nonetheless, within this scene, very, very, very huge moment. This, you know, Henry is willing to do and say whatever to protect his family, right? And he lets it slip out about the dog. You know, he tells, you know, Jonathan, like, yeah, you know, let's get a dog. Let's get the family together. And Jonathan's like, why can't we get a dog again? What's this now? And obviously we know about the dog. As we move forward, Jonathan's surprised. He wished that, you know, his Grace didn't say anything. And, you know, remember later, earlier in the episode, no more lies, Jonathan, no more lies. So, guys, let's break down this scene. So come to find out, Jonathan didn't kill the family dog. Hell, there was no dog. Come to find out that at the age of 14, Jonathan was tasked to babysit his sister, Katie. I believe they call her Kitten. He almost made it sound like it was a pet animal, that the sister was an animal in the family. But nonetheless, she was 4. He was making a sandwich. Unfortunately, she went outside and got hit by a car. Now, in Jonathan's eyes, he felt so bad about the situation. He wished that it would never happen. He wished he would have never been selfish enough to make a sandwich and not watch his little sister. Kind of making himself, you know, feel like the victim in the situation, right? And this kind of goes back to our intro conversation that we had last week. Who is the little boy in the intro? Who's the girl? We assumed it's Grace, you know, but it seems like, I don't know, it could have been Jonathan's sister, even though we see the little boy at a younger age. And it seemed to be a 14-year-old, but we saw the little girl, and I am to assume, I could be wrong, it could still be Grace's dream, this intro, this fantasy that we get at the beginning of the show, but I think that's his sister, Katie, and we see, or Kitty, the blood on the walls and all that stuff. I think that explains the intro of the show. Again, I could be wrong. Let me know if you guys think that ties into each other. But again, we just found out that there was no dog. This was his sister that died. And we'll talk a little bit more about what we get from his mother. But moving forward, we see Grace telling the father, you know, Franklin, what just happened and what she just learned. You know, Grace tried calling the mother. She didn't answer the phone. We'll talk about that. And we see Franklin say, well, even his family doesn't want him to be a part of their family. We'll get to that moment in a little bit. Jonathan and Fernando see each other before this next day of trial, before he takes the stand. Now, this is a very interesting moment here. We see him describing what happened the morning that he found Elena. We see, Sylvia walking into the courtroom a little bit late, and she locks eyes with Catherine. I'm just so curious of what that relationship is, why they seem to have this friendship, relationship. It'll be really interesting if that's anything at all. You know, we got one episode left. Is there a relationship between the two? We move forward. Again, Haley being a great lawyer, she turns to Fernando, and he calls her out for playing games, calls her vile, because she really goes at Fernando, right? We see within this moment, she goes at the throat. She talks about Elena wasn't completely honest with him, that, you know, she kept a separate apartment. Big moment here. She brings up the fact that he might have even knew about the affair, which he kind of alludes to in this scene, right? And was she under psychiatric treatment, and could have been other men in the situation? Again, Haley is just going for the juggler throughout this trial. I mean, she is ruthless. She said it when Grace met her. She's going to muck it up. She's going to shake things up. And she is definitely doing that, especially in this scene, because we see Fernando break out. He just screams it was Jonathan, and, you know, the look that he had. I mean, he just kind of broke, and it's not a good look for Fernando, right? Because it shows this emotion. This guy can get angry, right? If you say the wrong thing, do the wrong thing, he might lash out. In Haley's defense, and her kind of showing to the trial, to the jury, this guy has a temper. He might have killed his wife after finding out the news. So again, Haley's working her thing there, guys. So we see Grace call Sylvia to ask her opinion, which she actually says that she believes, based on everything she knows, that Jonathan did it. Again, Sylvia is just playing the background. I'm reading the comments. Some of you all suggest that Sylvia and Franklin had an affair, that, well, I mentioned it too. Sylvia and Jonathan having an affair, Sylvia and Catherine having something. I mean, Sylvia's just this wild card of a character. I don't know what to make of her quite yet. But again, she brings up the beyond reasonable doubt that they have that to their advantage. And Sylvia, she asks her, Grace, what are you thinking? When she says, I wish you never asked me that. Because we know Grace, she's going to be thinking about a lot of stuff, because she has a really interesting mind that we get into every now and then. So moving forward, we see Jonathan looking at the photos of Elena as Haley walks in and admits to loving Elena. Now, this is something we talked about last week when he said, I lost someone I loved. Did he really love her? Is he making this up? Again, what do we think about Jonathan? Can we trust the words that come out of his mouth? Does he have a heart? Does he have emotion? Which his mother talks about a little bit later. More lies from that man. As we kind of wrap up the episode, you see Grace heading to bed. She gets a return phone call from Janet, which is, you know, Jonathan's mom. They're having this conversation. By the way, is that Rosemary Harris, which is the aunt of Peter Parker in the Sam Raimi Spider-Man? Was that the same actress? I couldn't tell. But anyway, we see, you know, they haven't spoken since the wedding. She tells Grace that it was Jonathan's decision to no longer be a part of the family. We knew a couple weeks ago he was arranged from his family, and it kind of makes sense, because as she kind of moves forward, a decision he made long before Grace. So she brings up, you know, okay, I just found out about your daughter that passed away. She says, yes, he should be guilty. He should have some type of remorse. He should be upset, because it was his responsibility, and she does blame him for the death of their child. But then this is where things get a little bit more interesting. As she goes, he suffered no grief. He never suffered anything. More or less, Jonathan doesn't even know how to suffer. He never even said sorry, never mentioned her, and never came back when he was of age. So he just ran away from the situation. No emotion of potentially, let's be frank, being responsible for not paying attention to your little sister and being part of the reason why she went outside. She's 4 years old. She's having fun. Gets hit by a car. No remorse, no grief, no suffering. Again, this goes back to this mindset of Jonathan poking fun on the phone and just kind of making jokes about this serious situation at times. This guy is crazy, guys. This guy is crazy. We're going to talk about his son here in a bit. So as we kind of wrap up, Grace calls Sylvia to tell her the news. His mother calls him a sociopath. As she says, it was weird how that seems kind of framed, because it made her seem like she was like in a position of like, okay, they think it's Jonathan. I'm safe. Again, I don't know if Sylvia is responsible for this murder, but there's something about her character. Let me know what you all are thinking about her based on everything in this episode. So wrapping up the episode, big moment here. We end the episode with Grace checking on Henry as he's asleep. You know, she's cleaning up his room, picks up some things, something in his violin bag, and that something is a hammer. The hammer that was responsible, or at least we're to assume, is the murder weapon, the weapon that killed Elena in his bag. And we see he wakes up, sees his mom sees him. End of episode. Now, again, I showed you my highlights at the beginning of this episode about the reason why, you know, him not wanting his family to be broken up. So he went to the extreme by taking out the threat of what can be breaking up his family. Again, is this a huge misdirect? Just is this some theories? Could it have been Jonathan was the murderer? He did kill Elena. Jonathan saw this, took the weapon, hid it, didn't want his family to be caught. That's why he's watching the news. He wants to just make sure everything's going good for his father. Could he had told Miguel to get the weapon? That's why Miguel's not talking, because he took the weapon and is covering for his stepbrother, covering for his family. We know this family has a way with words. Could he have had Miguel get the weapon and give it to him? Or is it just the obvious that Jonathan killed Elena, brutally killed her? Or I'm sorry, Henry brutally killed her and hid the weapon because he's the murderer. Huge misdirect. Is it Henry? Or is it Jonathan? Or is it someone else? Is it Fernando? Is it Grace? Is it Sylvia? Is it Franklin? So many possibilities. One episode to find out. So, again, like I said up top, I thought this episode was fantastic. I thought the reveals were really well put together. I think the show does such a great job of giving you the mystery box and letting you a little bit in and taking you out and letting you in, taking you out. I thought that Haley's character was fantastic at what she did. I mean, just the words, the spin of the words, and just doing a great job being a lawyer. The stuff that we get again with Franklin and stuff, I was to say, with Jonathan and the reveal with his family and his sister that was dead. And I think, again, is that tie into the intro of the show? Was that the little girl that died? She looks to be about four. So, man, this was a really, really great episode before we get the finale next week, which brings me to my next point. I'm thinking about doing what I've done for shows like Defending Jacob, shows I've done for Lovecraft Country, as well as what we recently did with The Third Day on HBO. I'm thinking about doing a watch-along Sunday night, next Sunday, 8 p.m., or better yet, 7:45, 15 minutes before the show. We'll kind of pregame, we'll talk about our theories and have a good time, and then once the show comes on at 8, I'll watch it on my TV while you watch it at home, and we'll just kind of talk about the episode. We'll have a little discussion afterwards, and I'll give you all my normal review the following day. So that's something I'm thinking about doing. Let me know if that's something you're interested in. As always, I always love your comments, your interactions with the show. I love your theories, so definitely comment below and let's discuss this fifth episode and what we can expect in the finale. As always, make sure to like, share, comment, subscribe, hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of my other content that we do on this channel on a daily basis. Hope you all are staying safe. Hope you enjoyed this review, and we'll see you on the next video.